Good morning, everyone. So lovely to see your faces here today. I have a few announcements, but let's first read the vision statement for the church. Here at Davie United Methodist Church, God is transforming lives through the sharing and promise and the hope of God's love. Amen. Any birthdays or anniversaries this week? This young man over here, I can't see you very well, lights in my eyes. What's your name?
Stephen.
And Stephen, you have any special plans for your birthday this week? Nothing special? I think we all should go out to dinner with Stephen, don't you think? It would be great. Well, anybody else? No? I guess you're the one. Let's sing happy birthday to Stephen.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Okay. Something sad or something joyous. Of course, we all feel this way at times. The candle on the altar is for Rosemary Hammond, who went home to the Lord. So we need to pray for her husband, Richard, and for the family. So please keep them in your prayers. The Bread of Life is doing wonderfully well on Fridays at 9 o'clock. We invite people to come and to take care of the needs that they may have in the way of groceries. And so we would like to know if there's anyone that would like to come and help serve about 8:30 on Friday mornings. It is a blessing, and the way it makes you feel is so wonderful to see how the church helps these people. Also, we are always in need of food, so any donations are really welcome. We appreciate you all. Thank you so much. Come and join us Wednesday night for Bible study, the Book of Revelation. I believe they're finishing up chapter 4, so bring your Bible, come and talk, and come and have a discussion, and come and hear some history. Pastor Scott is so wonderful about explaining things to us. I think he actually lived through that, so he'll, you know, he knows so much about it. So we would love to have you come 7:30 on Wednesday evening. Please come and join us. I'm sorry, 7 o'clock on Wednesday evening. Please come and join us. The youth group Ignite meets on Friday nights at 6 p.m. They also meet on Sunday mornings at 10 a.m. for the youth Sunday school. Please come and check it out. If you have neighbors, friends, children of your own who might be interested in attending, please send them our way. It's a wonderful way for us to get to know the youth in the area and for them to experience what it's like to know Jesus. Tithing envelopes were shipped this Friday. Back up to COVID, that's why everything was a little bit late, so they will be here soon. Tithing statements will be emailed this week, and if you'd like a paper copy, you can get one at the office. We need some volunteers. Touch-up painting going on in Bragan Hall this Tuesday at 10 a.m. If you'd like to wear your painting clothes and bring a paintbrush, it's just some touch-up. We want to keep it looking fresh and clean for the people and for God. And so anyone here watching us on Facebook, YouTube, we would like very much for you to like and comment and share. It's a way for us to get our message out to the community. And we have a lot of people that watch us online, and I'm so grateful for that. Thank you, God, for letting us do that. And also thank you all for being here today. And now it is time for our morning prayer.
Good morning. Let us pray. Leading and guiding God, you have opened the doors to us for true service. We are encouraged to become involved in ministries of peace and justice. The light of the promise is reflected in your spirit, which rests in each one of us. Get us ready to serve you, guide our lives as we learn more of what you would have us do. Amen. Please rise.
Please remain standing for the reading of the Word of God. Our first reading this morning is from Corinthians, the first book of Corinthians, chapter 12, verses 12 through 31. Just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the foot, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with greater honor, and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect. Whereas our more respectable members do not need this, but God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts, and I will show you still more an excellent way. Please remain standing as we sing How Great Thou Art.
Thank you. Please be seated. Every week we pray for one of the local churches. This week we are praying for Davie Community Worship Center. Please pray for Pastor Feblin Bison and the congregation for health, prosperity, unspoken prayers, and joy for the congregation in the Lord. Let us now go to God in prayer. Lord of patience and persistence, the scriptures from Isaiah's scroll were not new to the people gathered on that day for worship. Many times before, they had heard the words and in their hearts hoped that the mandate could become a reality in their lives. But none moved forward. Then Jesus proclaimed that God had called him to bring good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. At last, with confidence, Jesus forced the issues and the mandate. God has fulfilled God's promise in the person of Jesus. Now something was going to be done. No more lip service, no more fear, no more waiting. Now the time had come. It is no different today than it was 2,000 years ago. We still want someone else to pick up the reins, to lead the charge, to do the work. But God, through the witness of Jesus, is calling each of us to the task. The promise of hope and justice is given to this world, and we have become bearers of that promise. Now is the time for work and witness. Now is the time for hope and peace. Now is the time for each one of us to do our part in establishing God's kingdom. Lord, get us ready for service. Pick us up, dust us off, and put us on the pathways of justice. Now please join with me in saying the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand as you are able. For the glory be to the Father.
Remain standing for the reading of the psalm. If you're a visitor here with us, we'd like to respond with music and with song. So I will play the response one time through. The chancel singers will then sing it, and then we invite you to join us.
Oh,
The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims God's handiwork.
Day to day it pours forth speech, and night to night declares knowledge.
There is no speech, nor are there words. Their voice is not heard.
Yet their voice goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world.
In them, God has set a tent for the sun, which comes forth like a bridegroom leaving his chamber, and runs its course with joy like a strong man.
Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them, and there is nothing hid from its heat. The law of God is just, reviving the soul.
The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul.
The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple.
The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart.
The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever.
The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold.
Sweeter also than honey, and drippings of the honeycomb.
By them is your servant warned, in keeping them there is great reward.
But who can understand one who's errors? Clear me from hidden faults.
Also, keep your servant from the insolent. Let them not have dominion over me.
Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
I have a song here. We all know Rock of Ages. Great song. Well, someone wrote another song that gave it the same name. But I like this song, so I'd like to do it for you. Rock of Ages. See the Rock of Ages till my
Thank you, Mike. Please stand as you're able for the reading of the Word of God. Today's reading comes from the book of Luke, chapter 4, verses 14 through 21. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, and to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." May the Lord bless this reading of his holy word. Please be seated.
Let us pray. Gracious God, loving God, God of grace and forgiveness, God of compassion and mercy, we thank you and we praise you. We thank you for this time of coming together and worshiping you. And we ask you to anoint us with your Holy Spirit so that we may listen to your words and that we may hear them in our hearts and that we may obey them in our lives. We ask all of this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Good morning. So at the 9 o'clock service, we do this time of prayer and praises, and we pass the microphone around, and it felt like almost every praise and prayer had something to do with COVID. And I don't know about you, but who's sick and tired of COVID? I am sick and tired of COVID. For those of you who didn't put your hands up right now, shame on you. I mean, who's not sick and tired of hearing about COVID? I mean, it is just, it has gotten a little much, right? So for those of you, most of you probably know this, but the church and the people that work here, including myself and a lot of the people that serve here, as many of you and your families have dealt with COVID over the last few weeks. Many of us have gotten sick and have had to stay home. Blessedly, most of those, and all of the ones that I know about, no one went to the hospital, and most of them have been pretty mild cases, including the people that worked here. Many of you know that I got sick because if you came here Christmas Eve, I wasn't here. And the reason why I wasn't here was because I was sitting on my couch watching you all and praying desperately that everything would go smoothly. And for the most part, it did, mostly because of, as we just read about in 1 Corinthians, the body of Christ here at Davie are made up of many, many people with talents that God has given us. And so what happened was 2 days before COVID, I put out a desperate text because I knew that I wasn't going to make it to Christmas Eve, asking basically the leadership of the church, who can give the sermon on Christmas Eve? And probably the following Sunday on the 26th, because I just knew that I wasn't going to make it. A bunch of people stood up and said that they could help in different ways. And we had Wesley, who's obviously got the talent and that God has given Wesley of speaking and public speaking. And so it was wonderful that Wesley was able to jump in and do the Christmas Eve sermons, and he did an excellent job. It was wonderful. And then we had another person who said that they could do the Sunday after Christmas, the 26th. And so one thing that I've learned a few things through this time of COVID, especially this last few weeks, as I was out for almost 2 weeks, and I had to really rely on other people. And it was a mild case, but I was at home and I needed to stay at home so I didn't get anybody else sick, and I was on the couch a lot. And so I got a text on Christmas Day, probably around noontime, that the person who was going to do the sermon on Sunday was not going to be here. Yes. It's like the worst nightmare type moment of trying to fill in a sermon on Christmas Day. So I'm sitting there looking at my phone, looking at the list of people that probably could do it, and that probably could do it on such short notice. And I was like, but who could I actually ask that's not going to end up probably hating me for the rest of their life? As I make this phone call on Christmas Day, and the one name that jumped out at me was Corky. And I know now that she'll probably never answer a Christmas Day phone call from me ever again. She probably thought I was calling to wish her Merry Christmas, which I did do in my defense, but the words out of my mouth next probably weren't the words she wanted to hear. And she was with family at the time. And Corky, if you get a chance to thank her, she's a faithful servant of God. Amen. She took it upon herself to do the sermon. With Wesley, I gave Wesley the sermon. He made it his own, but I at least gave him something to start with. With Corky, I was like, I got nothing for you. I ended up sending her some stuff later on that she was actually thinking about, which was really interesting what her sermon ended up being about. She was thinking about the Home Alone theme, and that was something I pulled off from Ministry Matters, which is one of the resources we use. But anyway, so it was a God moment. Corky came in and filled in at basically 12 hours notice on Christmas Day to give the sermon. Another thing that I learned over this time of me having COVID, and something that I've heard many times, but I kind of ignored and I kind of didn't think so because it had to do with this idea that men, when they get sick, are big babies, and women, when they get sick, handle it much better. And I kind of always didn't believe that because I just thought it was something that women made up to make us feel guilty. But what I realize is it's probably true because my COVID lasted for like 2 weeks. I was on the couch. I was a big baby. Lauren was working me back into health, slowly but surely, doing almost everything. And then Lauren ended up getting COVID. She was out for like 2 days, and she kept doing all of her normal things. And, you know, so in this one instance, for sure, the women came through and the men fell pretty disastrously in the process. But praise God, most of us are coming back from it. And I know I see some of you who have been struggling with COVID over the last few weeks and you're back. And we pray that this is going to be the end, right? We're finally going to get past this. And some things did happen when many of us were sick in COVID. There was a moment when all of us in the office, all of the people that work here, most people that work here had COVID. And it was from Christmas to New Year's. Now, thankfully, we close the office every year for that week between Christmas and New Year's. So we were already closed. And then all of us were sick or had COVID of some sort during that week. And I said, everyone just stay home, we're closed, stay away from the church, we don't want to get anyone else sick, and we'll just be closed, and we'll come back after the New Year strong. Well, while we were closed, some things happened here at the church that some of you know about, but some of you don't, and I wanted everyone to know what happened, and I want you to hear it from me, so that there's no gossip or anything, stories being told that make what happened seem worse or different than it really was. So what happened was, while we were gone, or really before Christmas, we had been letting a group of homeless men, about 4 to 5 of them, come to the church to receive help and aid. Now, we've done this many times in the past, and many times we've helped these homeless people get back on their feet. There has been some moments where we had to ask some people to leave for different issues of bad behavior. But for the most part, it's been pretty calm since I've been here. We've done many things at this church to help those that are in need, the homeless. We have the feeding ministry Friday mornings starting at 8:30. You're more than welcome to come and see that and serve there. It's a great way to serve and help others. We have the thrift store from 9 a.m. on Saturdays to 1 p.m. And we oftentimes give homeless people the clothing for free. We don't charge them when they need new clothes. We have the showers. When I first came here, we had the men's shower, and that was it. We had the one shower that we would let both men and women. We'd lock the door up, but when we did the renovation, we added a shower to the women's room specifically to let homeless people come here, take showers, get cleaned up, get new clothes, and feel refreshed. We've also at times let certain people come and sit at the front where we have outlets on both sides during the day, charge their phones, get out of the sun, especially during the summertime, and have a place of a few hours of being safe. And so what happened was right leading up to Christmas in December, we had a group of about 4 to 6, probably 5 or so men, homeless. But as we found out, they all had a dramatic heroin or opioid addiction. Now, most people that are homeless, or a lot of people homeless, not all, but a good portion, are dealing with some addiction or mental illness or something. So that's not totally abnormal or unheard of, but what happened was is that when we in the office closed down and we were all sick from COVID, the gentlemen that were coming here took advantage of the situation. We had multiple complaints from our neighbors saying that they were going and stealing packages. We had complaints from the preschool. We even had one of the homeless guys jump the fence during the operating hours of the preschool and was in the preschool playground area. We have that on tape. And so the cops, the police officers from Davie were called by many people, the preschool, the neighbors, and we ended up speaking to them. By the time this kind of happened, I was feeling better, and the first service I came back to was January 2nd, right after the new year. And when I came, normally Rob, our sexton, walks around the campus before each Sunday morning, like at 7 o'clock in the morning, and gets up and makes sure that everything is looking good and safe and there's no issues. And so he was in the apartment because he was overcoming COVID, and I asked him to stay inside. I did the walk around that morning, and what I found was really problematic in a huge degree. We had basically 6 homeless people sleeping at the front of the church, but as I asked them to get up and move, I saw needles and heroin packets all over the front of the church from where they had been using. I could tell that all of them were drug-induced. There was a couple of other issues where we had women who, at our Wednesday night Bible study, as they were walking out of the Bible study, they were being followed, and even this happened on Christmas, that some were being followed to their cars by some of the homeless people that were obviously on drugs at the time. So this happened in a moment, and I was the one homeless person that had already had an overdose on the campus. At that time, when we were cleaning up their mess and dealing with the needles and other paraphernalia, he came up. I, at that time, asked him to leave the campus. From that moment on, we have asked Davie Police Department to help us basically keep all of the homeless from camping out and staying here for long periods of time, and especially if they're using drugs or doing anything that like that, that they're no longer welcome on the campus. This was a decision that I made in that moment, and it was based upon many stories and understanding that basically we had lost control of the situation on the campus. The people that are supposed to be here all the time, we were, by letting them be here, I felt like we were making this an unsafe situation for especially the children and women that come here. And so I made that decision. Now, this is a difficult conversation and a tricky understanding of scripture and understanding of how we're supposed to treat people that are less fortunate than us, and in this scripture where it says the word poor, okay? So in this scripture, this is this very famous moment in scripture where Jesus goes back to his hometown, and we didn't read the whole scripture, we just read the first seven verses, but Jesus returns to Nazareth, his hometown, and he's preaching at the synagogue. And at the beginning of this, his first section, he reads from the Torah, from the scrolls of the Old Testament, and he's reading specifically from Isaiah, and he's reading from verse 61 and 58. This is actually a combination of two sections, one in mostly in 61 Isaiah, and some of it is from 58 Isaiah. Both of these scriptures, these chapters in 58 Isaiah and 61 Isaiah, are speaking about specific issues and things happening in the life of the people, the Jewish people. And in 58, it's talking about how the people are living out their Sabbath. And the complaint here by the prophet Isaiah, and one thing to acknowledge, there's really two big issues the prophets are usually talking about, especially in the Old Testament, when they're complaining to the people about why God's angry with them. And one we've talked about quite a bit, which is that the people have turned away from God and started to do what? Worship idols. That they're worshiping other gods or false idols. The other big issue that God has when the prophets speak is this idea of the people are not doing justice. They are not helping those that are less fortunate, those that are struggling in life. So those really are two of the big issues that we see the prophet speaking out by telling the people why God is angry. And they do this usually like we've talked about in the first person representing God or the third person. So in 58, what we see is God is angry because the people are misusing their Sabbath. They're using their Sabbath only for themselves and focusing on their own issues and thoughts about themselves, and they're ignoring this call to action by God to help those that are oppressed. And then in 61, the whole chapter is really about righteousness. It's about what does it mean to be righteous, and who are the righteous? And we have this section that is being used by Jesus here in Luke 4, that starts out by saying this, and this is in the first two verses of Isaiah 61, and then the 18th verse here in chapter 4. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. Sound familiar? The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Spirit God has anointed Jesus with the Holy Spirit. We say that over and over again here in worship, that God will anoint us with God's Spirit to bring good news to the poor. To bring good news to the poor. What does this word poor mean? So what happens quite often in translations, especially from Hebrew or Greek to the English, is that the word or the words in Hebrew or Greek usually has very specific meaning, and there's many words that really get translated to the same thing in English, because English, we have in a lot of our language one word that means many things. And that's what's happening here. This word poor is translated into English to a word poor, which for us means a huge group of people. We would all admit there are different types of poor people. Can we admit that? That there are different types of people that are poor. Some that are poor by the circumstances of the world, of the way the governments treat the people, the way that we treat each other. Some are poor because of certain decisions that people have made that are probably not the best decisions in their life. And some have done, there's a combination of that. It's not just one group of people, all people are the same. But what happens here is this word poor, which is actually, this is a quote from Isaiah 61. So this is a quote from the original Hebrew, which is actually, the word being used here is anawim. Anawim. And it's used many times throughout the Old Testament, a lot of times in the Psalms, in the prophets, and it's used quite often in Isaiah, and it's used here in 61. So the word there is not poor, it's anawim. The original Hebrew word there is anawim. Now, anawim does not mean all poor people. It's actually talking about a specific group of poor people. And as we look at it throughout the Old Testament, a lot of times what it's really referring to, and that's why this word actually in some translations is not poor, but it's people that are oppressed or people that are contrite. It's people that for different circumstances are not blessed through material goods or power in society, and many times they have given that up, and they've given it up to focus on chasing God. So a lot of these people, the Anawim, the people that are called Anawim, were people that were poor in material things, but they were reaching out, they were struggling to find God in their life because they knew that they needed God more than anyone else. Because they were without these goods, these things that other people had. So they had to depend on God more than anyone else in the world. That's why it's used in 61 when the whole chapter of 61 is talking about righteousness. We believe this translation of Anawim are people that maybe are poor in spirit or poor in things of the world, but they are righteous in the eyes of God. That they are contrite in spirit, that they are searching for something better, that they want to be helped. They need help, they're asking for help, and they want it in their life. And this is really where we get to this tricky understanding of how do we deal with people that we, as society, and even in church language, we say all these people are poor. We are called to help them, to share with them the good news of Scripture, and to give them help in the way that they're living their life, to help them find a better way. But that there are certain people that the world deems and calls poor, but really, they are not interested in receiving help. And we know, if we're honest with ourselves, we run into people like this probably often when we feel like maybe they're trying to take advantage of the system so that they can continue to live a lifestyle that is outside of relationship with God. And the tricky part is, how do we deal with this? How do we deal with this in our lives, in the life of the church, from a scriptural understanding? And because we are going to have to stand in front of God one day and have to explain our actions, aren't we? So this is something that as Christians we really struggle with. This is not an easy conversation. The one thing I will say is in no way am I advocating that because you see somebody who is manipulating, maybe a drug addict, maybe somebody who's taking advantage of the system, we are called to love all people. Amen? That includes people that we dislike, our enemies, and it includes people that maybe are doing things that we don't agree with. We are called to love them with everything we got. But there's also a point of discernment, and this goes back to the original line that Jesus says when he's quoting Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the anawim, to the contrite in spirit, to the one that is looking and needing help, that is desperately in need of God in their life and are struggling with the world, those that are, yes, maybe they've made some mistakes, but they're there to be helped and they want to receive that help. We go back to the book of Psalms, and as we've talked about Psalms over the last 6 months or so, we know that the Psalms are a huge source of theological knowledge. It is the most quoted book of the Old Testament by Jesus Christ. At least 40% of all of Jesus' quotes to the Old Testament are from the book of Psalms. It is packed with theological understanding and information. It's not just songs or poems. It's teaching us our relationship with God. And this is what's said in Psalm chapter 34, starting in verse 15. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry. The face of the Lord is against evildoers, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears them. This is the anawim. These are the people that are righteous, that are calling out for God's help, and God is going to help them. The Lord hears and rescues them from all their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord rescues them from them all. He keeps all their bones. Not one of them will be broken. Evil brings death to the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be condemned. So if you've heard that the pastor of your church has thrown off the homeless and are not allowing the homeless to be a part of this church or be here on the church property, I want you to say, that's not true. All of the homeless people, including the people that were doing the things that we talked about, are still allowed to come onto the campus, to come to the feeding ministries, to make an appointment, to take a shower, to come to the office, to get help, counseling, to get bags of food. All of that is still going on. The only thing that we are no longer allowing is for them to sit at the front of the church and do evil things and to take advantage of our love for them. And if you have an issue with the way that we're handling it, I understand. Please come and talk to me. I promise you, I have been and will continue to be someone who is advocating for this church to love desperately the people that are lost in this world. But at the same time, I am called to be your shepherd, which means that at certain points, I'm called to protect you. And what I decided to do in that moment was in that lines that I felt like I was not protecting you by allowing certain people to be here and take advantage of what we're doing. Amen? We are loving the people in this world. We will continue to love the people in this world and bring the good news of Jesus Christ to as many people that will listen to it and accept it. We cannot force this upon anyone. And if people want to make bad decisions, we cannot stop that. But we will continue to love as much as we possibly can. And I hope if anyone had any questions about this, I know that it's the last few weeks have been a little hectic with the COVID and everything that's happened. I didn't know how much everybody knew about the situation, but that's why I wanted for us to talk about it in this sermon. We are called by God to be a part of the transformation of the world, but not everyone is going to accept that love of Jesus Christ. And sometimes there's nothing we can do about it. But we have some wonderful things happening here at the church, and you're invited to be a part of them. The feeding ministries on Friday, the thrift store, there's things happening throughout the week where we help those that are less fortunate, and we're going to continue to do that, and we're actually going to grow those memories, those ministries. So I ask you, be a part of that. And most of you are already doing something. You're giving, you're tithing, you're bringing in food, bringing in clothes. That's awesome. And that's what this church is about and what this church will continue to be about. Amen? Let us pray. Gracious God, we love you. We love you and we thank you for all the blessings you pour out. And we thank you for the ability to serve the people in this community. But we also know that there are difficult things that we have to figure out. And we ask you to give us your Holy Spirit that we will discern how we are called by you to help those in need in this world. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Please stand with us as we sing our closing song, My Tribute to God Be the Glory.
So as we go forth, there are plates at each exit. These are for your tithes, your gifts, and your offerings. If you're watching online, God bless you. There is an orange giving button on the Davie UMC website about halfway down the homepage as for your tithes, your gifts, and your offerings as well. We know that God will bless you through your giving. Amen? So as you go forth, go with the Holy Spirit in your heart. And allow the Holy Spirit to help you to see where God is calling you in helping those in need in this world. God bless you and go in peace. Amen.